strong, can't stop, won't stop from the Brooklyn block.
Fitting the score next. My J is all net. Me and Jay, that you saw next. Getting back on defense, hit him with strong flex. I'm official like a ref, trying not to get attacked. And we go hard on Brooklyn, that's a promise. Watch me like a cam, cause it's my time. Make sure watch me like a cam, cause it's my time. Switch, they can't guard me, especially side the Barclays. Spin between crosses, so I can score with both hands. Mini flawless, and I get to paint like an artist. I'm a boss smith, so you should respect my handle. I see the big picture with the Nets like a mantle. In the future, I see us as champs. And when we do, I'ma do a Brooklyn dance move. Disturb that whole Millie rock like a fan do. And that's a bet like my parlay on FanDuel.
Choice every day, what that looks like for you. Being steadfast, keeping your nerve, don't lose your shit with this group. Being tougher as a group.
Oh, what a move by Sharp, counted him a foul.
B-R-O-O-K-L-Y-N. B-R-O-O-K-L-Y-N.
Block party, claps and double digits. Got the ball play, clicking, the whole block is with it. Left a lot on the table, now we coming to get it. The shook one gone, we too Brooklyn strong. Can't stop, won't stop from the Brooklyn block.
Fitting the score next. My J is all net. Me and J that you saw next. Getting back on defense, hit him with strong flex. I'm official like a ref, trying not to get attacked. And we go hard on Brooklyn, that's a promise. Watch me like a cam, cause it's my time. Make sure watch me like a cam, cause it's my time. Switch, they can't guard me, especially side the Barclays. Spin between crosses, so I can score with both hands. Mini flawless, and I get to paint like an artist. I'm a boss smith, so you should respect my handle. I see the big picture with the Nets like a mantle. In the future, I see us as champs. And when we do, I'ma do a Brooklyn dance move. Disturb that whole Millie rock like a fan do. And that's a bet like my parlay on FanDuel.
B-R-O-O-K-L-Y-N. B-R-O-O-K-L-Y-N. B-R-O-O-K-L-Y-N.
Choice every day.
Yeah. Yo, it's Big Fan Breezy with the Brooklyn Nets vlog, and yeah, man, we talking Brooklyn Nets basketball for a minute. I know you Knicks fans and Philly fans want to talk basketball. Jack City is a Knicks fan. Andre 76 is a 76er fan. Definitely want to get them on the panel. Yeah, shout out to my guy Talal Monteza. We out here, man. Share the stream. Like, share, comment. subscribe. Mo Beezy says, salute, Breezy. I'm checking in on our investment. Yo, man, I'm trying to see what's going on, man. I want to see if Leaf is going to pull up. I don't know if he's busy or not, but Zach Eadie played on the Canadian team that Jordi Fernandez coached. Jordi Fernandez coached the same team that Zach Eadie was on. So we'll read. National team career. Eadie represented Canada at the 2021 FIBA Under 19. This is when he was under 19. Basketball World Tour in Latvia. He averaged 15.1 points in the tournament high, 14.1 rebounds, and 2.3 blocks per game, leading his team to the bronze medal and being named to the All-American team. On May 24, 2022, Eadie agreed to a three-year commitment to play with the Canadian C and men's national team. Eadie was selected by Coach Jordi Fernandez. Eadie was selected by Coach Jordi Fernandez. If Zach Eadie might be more on the radar than we know, where is Leaf at? Eadie was selected by Jordi Fernandez, by Coach Jordi Fernandez. Where is Leaf at? Where are you at? Saint said, what up, Breezy? Yo, what up, man? We got to cook. Not like that. I mean, pause. You know how it is on social media. You know what I mean? I say cook. They might think cooking together like I'm actually dicing up onions and peppers like over with Saint. Like, no, I'm not saying that. I mean, we got to cook on the topic of Zach Eadie and Jordi Fernandez. I want y'all to be clear. I didn't read anymore because this part is what y'all want. I want y'all to hear again. Eadie was selected by Coach Jordi Fernandez. Selected. That means I could pick this guy, that guy, or this guy. I am going to pick this guy. I'm going to leave this up here until Leaf show up. I'm going to leave this here until my guy show up. Because I don't want to hear no pessimistic shit from Leaf when it come down to the possibility of us getting a Eadie. I was the one that was kind of saying, I don't see how it's possible. I don't see how they would do it. I don't see how. I always said how. But when I see this, I got to be honest, man. Leaf was cooking with something. He was cooking up some. So, you know, I'm not going to hold you guys, man. I'm going to throw the link in the chat. We're going to see what's going on, man. Shout out to Saint from Nets Kingdom. Subscribe to Nets Kingdom. Shout out to Jack City. And Nick fan, but, you know, I know him in real life. He cool. Why is he talking spicy? Who is he talking spicy to? He says, so y'all basically giving Houston another top 10, possibly top 5 pick next summer, right? No, I ain't saying that. You ain't hear me say that. Eadie was selected by Coach Jordi Fernandez. Wow. Zach Eadie going into the draft. Jordi Fernandez, same season, getting a head coach situation. Now, in a coach, want to get a guy who he played with right out the draft? Is Jordi Fernandez trying to build the Brooklyn Nets team around Zach Eadie?
What up, Breezy?
Yo, talk to me, say, what's going on, man?
I don't know. Okay, I'm not going to dive into that because, again, they still haven't announced, dude. I don't know if you're taking everything that you've heard from Sean Marks yesterday, reading Scotto's report, just in general conversations, like flexibility seems to be the key. And it seems like they're going to go into any of these discussions potentially with a star or not. And I wonder how much that flexibility is going to maintain, like, because you're getting mixed messages. On one hand, they're telling you they want to build around, and you think that means Cam Clowney, Claxton, other young guys. But then you hear, I had an off the conversation with Scotto, I mean, off the record. Well, I wouldn't say off the record, really. Just in the DM. Just
on Twitter or whatever.
Yeah, but it was in the DM. We were talking about his report he just put out, and I was kind of just throwing questions around about the Donovan Mitchell, and at one point I kind of just said, like, okay, if Donovan Mitchell is that target, like, obviously you're going to see picks. Obviously I would think they're going to ask for a young guy, and then obviously you have to throw in some of the other players for contracts, whether it's a Dodo, whether it's whoever.
Right.
And I said, but the thought that I can't shake, though, is who, like, what's it going to cost? Because it's like the conversation they're giving you is kind of mixed. They're saying we want to remain flexible and build our youth, but they're also saying they want to go star hunting. And it's just like, when you hear all these things, it's like, okay, that's great. And that reflects their flexibility of picks, right, players. You know, they have a lot of enticing and positive assets.
Mm-hmm.
But you have to ask yourself, if they do go for Donovan Mitchell, what's it really going to cost you?
Me personally, like I said, I'm not stressing Donovan Mitchell, because when you look at Cam Thomas and him being, in my opinion, on the brink of being a star, I think he's somebody that we should focus on, especially when you look at the business side of it, productivity-wise, for him to be in conversations at MIP, not necessarily.
I don't disagree with that, Breezy, but stay focused, because it's gonna, you know, it's gonna cost somebody.
But not him, not Cam Thomas.
Oh, I hope not. But that's the problem with Sean.
But let me ask you this: what has Donovan Mitchell did so much that we would need him here?
Okay, I mean, Katie and Kyrie, real quick for the conversation. I'm with you. I don't think we need to go trade for him, right? Especially with him being a free agent, like, you run the risk of marks. Like, I don't really, like, he's a cool player and it'd be cool to have him on the team. But if you're asking me, no, I don't want him. But I mean, we can't sit here and pretend. Like, I guess the point I'm trying to say is, as much as I want this or you want that or the fan wants this, it's like, we got to start thinking in terms of Sean Marks. And what is Sean Marks going to do?
But that's what I'm saying. See, when I vlog like that, I always find myself upset, because it just seemed like leading up to the conversation around Jared Allen. You know, he was drafted. That was Sean Marks' draft pick. So when he didn't get the bag, I just thought, like, yo, I don't understand.
Well, like, but Breezy, well, look at it.
I just want to say this last thing. Sorry. Is that I stopped vlogging about what I think they're going to do. I vlog like, yo, this is what I want the Brooklyn Nets to do, and I hope they listen to the fans. That's when vlogging style.
No, I get that. I guess the only thing to, not even really a pushback or anything, but just to highlight that part about Jared Allen is, I mean, you got to imagine too, though, they had Katie and Kyrie already. So when it came to, like, that was like a no-brainer for them. And most people, I wanted to keep certain players, but I mean, at the end of the day, it's different making a trade now in comparison to when you had two superstars already on your team. Like, mm-hmm. I could understand cashing in on your young guys then, because it's like, yo, we got this window, right? Like, if that window never closes because of injuries and COVID, I mean, who knows? Mm. But to your point, yeah, I get that. I guess I for me, it's like, when I also kind of, maybe I'm opposite of what you were saying, Breezy, where it was like, I'm getting tired of talking about what I want. And I've been doing that for decades.
Mm-hmm.
And it never seems to get, you know, there's a point in the conversation where you can be like, yo, I hope they do this, I hope they do that. And then I feel like there's a point in the conversation where it's like, okay, they're not going to do that, and they're going to do this, and oof, let's hope this works.
Right, but that's what I'm saying. It don't work. A lot of the times that I see them doing what they do, it, a lot of the times they try to do what they do, and it don't work. And one of the things that I stood out in a press conference from Clax was, you know, I hope that he says, I hope the front office sees that us with a big front court is working. It helps me. I like playing alongside Clowney. Spoke highly about it. But my thing is, could they fit a Clowney, Zach Eddy, and Claxton? Because it seemed like if we want to get a Zach Eddy, we will have to lose Claxton. And Eddy being on the team seems way more possible if they would try to do a sign and trade for Clack so we could get Eddy. And I think that's the direction they want to go. And I think they want to, I think Clack wants to be on a competitive team. In a perfect world, like you say, vlogging, what are they going to do or what I want them to do. Now, what I want them to do, Saint, is find a way to keep Clax, get Zach Eddy, and develop Clowney. But I really feel like they don't know how to keep Clax and Zach Eddy on the same team. And they'll take Zach Eddy because the experience he has with a Jordi Fernandez.
Yeah. Let's look at it this way. Like, I don't, because that's the thing. Like, when you talk about what fans want, like you and you've heard it up here. Like the conversation is mixed on Clacks. Some people want them. Some people don't want them. Like everybody has got one guy they want or don't want. But you're kind of illuminating what I was saying before, though. Is it's like again, you add this Eddy guy into the picture, and it's like, okay, I see it and I'm with it, but again. Like people have to understand, like you can't keep everybody. I think the number one player you have to keep obviously is Cam Thomas, but that's, thank God you have another season. You don't have to really knock on that door 100% yet. And according to like Brian Lewis and Scotto in their report today, they were talking about addressing Cam Thomas's extension and Macau. And they both were like, they don't see it like happening ahead of the time. They definitely see it more towards the end of the season, if not the off season. They were talking about Cam Thomas and a $20 million. Like that's what he would be. So I'm just, again, you're looking at all this news, add this guy, move that guy. We're star hunting. I still got to sign this guy. Like, and you already know that they, and I think you can tell that they were planning a little bit for this with some of the moves that they did make as far as just being in the position of flexibility. But If your dream of Eddy comes, because it sounds like you really want this guy, right?
Well, again, I didn't know nothing about him until Leaf pulled up and he was telling me all about Zach Eddy. I'm kind of waiting for him, man. He ain't get here yet, so I'm kind of tight. But shout out to Saint, got the panel on fire. We got This Is Jay in the building. We got Claude Smith, Mo Beasy, Talal. We out here, man. Next phase is the best fans. But he brung it to my attention, and I looked at him and seen what he was doing. I followed him in the NCAA. He looked like a hooper. He looked like somebody that does fit. I totally agree with Leaf on his take on how essential a Zach Eddy would be to this team. And to know that a Jordi Fernandez, and let's be specific, let's see what happened actually. Eddy was selected by Coach Jordi Fernandez to play in 2023 FIBA Basketball World Cup, becoming the only college player in the team. That's interesting. On September 3rd, they qualified to the quarterfinals, securing a berth at the 2024 Summer Olympics, the first Olympics appearance for Team Canada since 2000. Canada won the bronze medal over the United States in the third-place game. This was Canada's first ever World Cup medal and first medal at a major global tournament since the 1936 Summer Olympics, for what it's worth. But that being said, he putting up history with Jordi Fernandez. I got a real strong sense that he is going to get Zach Eddy, and it might come from a sign and trade with Clax. Happy birthday.
Well, I mean, but okay.
Yesterday, Clax. Happy birthday, Clax. But I don't know how they keep Clax happy with Zach Eddy on the floor too.
He
didn't play that many games because it's an 82-game season. So I don't think it's Zach Eddy. I don't know. That's a lot to ask. But
you just addressed that was number one. Like, say they do acquire him. Right. Like there's going to be we just don't know how he'll respond. And obviously he's got to go through that grind. But does it cost you? It doesn't have to cost you, Claxton. I mean, I said this before. Where is this guy projected?
I'm hearing first, second round. You know, Nets Press was saying that too. I was trying to get Nets Press. He'd be knowing about all of this.
I'm just curious to see where this guy falls because the other day I put a tweet out because if you haven't figured out, I like the forward think a lot. And it's like,
I was kind of doing that like before this was like the videos yesterday were dropped about, you know, Mark saying yet. Because it just like the history shows that he always plays with second rounds and two ways, right? Like he has shown that he's willing to buy and dabble in that market, even if they don't have a pick or they have crappy ones. My question then will become, I mean, I could easily see us getting a first from some of the trades that we potentially should be making. But the question will be, are any of them for this season? I guess that's also going to depend on the type of player that we're giving up and questioning, you know, that team. How much does that team value? Is that team more interested in, is it more of a contender where we can get their pick and we give them a guy that's going to help them? And that's how we try to go shopping and finagling. We'll see. I mean, it's interesting. I'm like, I do love this aspect of, I'll say this and get out of here, but I do love the fact that we are walking into this and there is many avenues, and I love that the conversation that you create, even if people don't agree, like there's so many avenues that could work out. And there's some avenues where we've seen Mark's be like, yeah, I wish you would have handled that better. So hopefully this is one of those things. Like at the end of the day, as a Nets fan going into next season, whatever happens, just please learn from your mistakes. That's all I ask as a fan. Just don't go out and mismanage all these assets once again. And then, because arguably whatever decisions Marks makes this season and potentially next season, if he's here and he doesn't shit the bed, is going to set the team up either very good or bad for the next 5 to 6. I mean, but, you know what I'm saying? Like
I'm with you. What I'm saying, knowing the implications, again, this is why I did this specific stream. I think Jordi Fernandez, with the success he had on that Canadian team, wants to start with Zach Eddy. Him being in the draft and becoming a head coach, is it a coincidence or is perfect timing? Call it what you want. As a Nets fan, it looked like a good situation. If it
works out in their favor, yeah, totally. Like, I don't think it's – like, you can't guarantee that we're going to draft this guy. But if you – in the process of making – see, this is the thing. I don't want them to go out and just make a Donovan Mitchell trade to do this or just go all through this crazy shit just to get this one guy. Make the right moves. And if you find yourself in a position to draft a first-rounder or a second-rounder this year, you do it and you go after the guy you want. But it should not be your number one priority.
What up, Jay? Talk to me, Jay.
I feel like they at the very least are making Claxton very aware of the things that are going on, because as soon as Claxton said they're going to make a coaching decision really soon, the next day we got a new coach. Like, he knows what's going on. They did the thing, gave him his little his deal with the merch line and clothing. They're trying to keep him happy, and they want to probably negotiate and get him to a number that's happy for everybody.
Right, and I think that part is huge with the clothing line and just the branding. And again, to be honest with you, in Clack's spare time, I think he spoke on how he wanted to be invested in fashion. And what better place than, you know, Brooklyn, New York? You play, come on, this is the area for that. Everybody know we famous for it. So, of course, you can do it other places, but this is the best place for it. So, again, it just shows that we have interest in Clacks and what he wants, not just what we want from him, but how could we make it good for you, make it benefit for you, you know what I mean? So I think that's a good look on the Brooklyn Nets. And we need that change, too, where we given the giving the same respect to the draft picks that we do to free agents. Free agents come in, do what they want, and then leave. The draft picks, we just treat them like they don't matter as much as the free agents. And if you look at our current roster, our draft picks are more important than the free agents, respectfully. You feel what I'm saying? So that's how I look at it. And if we could build a culture with the draft picks being more important, then it would show a strength in the culture of building, of being in a franchise, because you not only making a dream come true. Again, when you first come into the draft, that's part of a dream coming true. That's the honeymoon stage, for lack of better terms. right? So you get in, and you know, if it's just you feel like it's business right away, even though it is business, but if they make you feel like that on a constant basis, it's gonna feel some type of way. And them doing the clothing line, I said, I would like to say them giving Clax that clothing line, I think it was something Clax, they knew he was interested in. And you know what I mean? They followed up on their word that they gave the Clax. I think that's a good look.
All the markings are there, Breezy. You said it. All the markings are there. He's saying what a free agent should say. He bet on himself. He won, and he's about to cash in. You can't tell me dude's not going to go for the biggest contract. Hopefully, like you're saying, Breezy, that there is enough there that he wants to stay. A lot of people are thinking he wants to go back down south to some degree, being in South Carolina. A lot of people are speculating he wants to do that. I hope he stays. Even if for the sake of not letting him walk, he's always going to be, even at that price, you can't tell me somebody would not pick him up. There's no way. Like, somebody would pick him up easily.
Yeah, no, that's the easy part, Saint. Of course.
Yeah.
So my thing is with him is, again, him being an unrestricted free agent, he got all the say, you know what I mean? He could kind of move around the way he want because he's not restricted. If y'all who don't know, the restricted free agents, I ain't going to lie. I just learned this the other day for sure. Let me not front.
You're a humble dude. I get it. No, I don't know half the shit. Yeah.
The restricted free agent, the team that was drafted that player, they can match the offer sheet. With an unrestricted free agent, Clax could get a contract from a team and the Brooklyn Nets can't do nothing about it. They can't match it, nothing. He could leave and be like, you know, it doesn't matter if y'all match it. But that's because this is his second contract. All rookie scale contracts have that, and that's a 3-year contract, right? So the rookie scale contract Clax was on, it ended, and he's now on a 2-year contract. But when his contract switched is when he went from restricted free agent to unrestricted free agent. So, you know, Cam Thomas next. I only said that to say I'm looking at a tweet, and it says via Mike Scotto, you mentioned him. He says, as of today, I don't see Cam Thomas in the Nets agreeing to a contract extension. But it's a situation I'll certainly monitor all summer.
I was talking about earlier when they were in that conversation. The broader part of that conversation was them talking about Cam Thomas and Mikal's contract and how that they didn't see both of them getting an extension right now. It didn't mean that it's not coming. Just they didn't foresee it like right now so early. They still have, because let's be honest, we already know that the Nets like to shuffle players around, especially when they're going to re-sign. Like, their whole idea is to stay under the tax. They're going to constantly try to remain flexibility and being able to re-sign these guys without any issues. And it's like, that's the biggest thing. Like, because you already know, they're like 2025-26 season, I think they're all but telling you we're making a splash in one way, shape, or form.
Yeah.
And I think they're going to look at this season that they're going to try to improve things, bring in other players. They might try to take a swing at a big player, but I'm also prepared for a very similar team and then the big splash the following season. That wouldn't surprise me either.
This is where I'm at with it right now. And to be honest with you, right, because it is what it is. I got Zach Eddy at the starting five, Clax at the starting four, Mikal at the starting three. I got Cam Thomas at the two. I got Schroeder at the one. I got Clowney coming off the bench. I got Sharp there, hopefully. I got CJ there, hopefully. I definitely got Trendy Wofford, the backup point guard. And I don't have nobody for the two. I don't know if Lonnie Walker stays with the team, to keep it real with you. Not to say I don't like Lonnie, but his accessibility, I see.
Well, they're all not staying. The question is, which guy do they find more value, right? You got to, if you're going to do the twin connection where you gave CJ, then I mean Watford's Cam's buddy. You know what I'm saying? Like, I hope they keep Watford around, but they did bring up a good point too in the article. It's going to be interesting to see how much Jordy views some of these current players and how much he's actually going to have input and go, and then that can circle back to your Eddy guy. Like, I think that's part of this big question, is how much are they trusting Jordy right off the bat? They like him because he was the highest rated GM by GM survey, assistant coach. There's a lot of things that like Sean Marks likes to hear. And the question will be like, okay, how much are you giving a first-time NBA head coach, not to negate his experience, but how much control is he actually going to give him? How much input is he actually going to listen to? And will that affect somebody like Watford or, for your sake, getting Eddy?
Mm-hmm. But no, but also, so this is the reason why I feel like they gave the nod to Jordi Fernandez over Kevin Ollie. Now, you hear all of the great things, and you see, you know his history about what he did in NCAA, winning a championship. You know all of this already. But the thing about it is his assistant coach experience is not even a whole full year. He became an interim head coach going in towards the latter part of his first season as an assistant head coach. So I think they give the nod to Jordi Fernandez because of his tenure as an assistant head coach. You know, again, he's moved around the league too and been on championship teams. And you know, I was watching in the Kings the other day to see how many points the other team scored. They had 94. I'm like, oh, all right, that's under 100. You know what I'm saying? I respect it. You know, I pay attention to that kind of thing. You know what I mean? So I think Jordi would value a player like Clax, I would imagine. But I will take back, I don't know how they would do it. I think they would start Clax and Clowney, but Zach Eddy would get big minutes. I think that's how it would work.
And if you do bring in a Zach, like say your Zach Eddy dream comes true, like you would think Dayron gets moved. Nobody seems to really like it's gonna hurt somewhere. And depending, somebody's favorite player, I don't know who it is. Favorite player on the Nets is not gonna be here next year.
That's my guy. Yo, he got a lot of favorite players, but I would say Jay, I root for him too, but I think I like Cam Thomas more than Dayron Sharp. But Dayron Sharp, he's good, but I think just on that pick and roll switch on the defensive side of the ball, he get beat a lot. And you get a Clowney who outperforms him in that area. You know, he has better defense on the perimeter on a switch. Him and Claxton have better defense than Dayron Sharp. And I think that's where, you know, Dayron Sharp, if anybody was going to get traded, I would have to say Day-Day. Day-Day.
Did you read what they said about Clowney this morning? Did you read about that?
No. Tell me. I just pulled up.
And just adding more, they really envision him as a four that can play small ball five. Like they're from what they were also talking about in the article, they said that they're extremely high on Clowney. Like, so Clowney is like a golden child. I think the words were golden child by them.
Golden child is an understatement. I ain't gonna lie. Yeah. I honestly believe like, he's been the player that we've been looking for all along. At least one of the major pieces. The fact that he could stretch the floor and basically come through in a lot of situational NBA circumstances is much needed, bro. Breezy didn't bring nobody up for his 46-minute episode last time. I was trying to tell him that I had found out from somebody. At Raptors Freak that Team Canada's coach was Jordi Fernandez. I actually found that out 2 days ago. And I was trying my hardest to get up here and tell people. I'm like, Zach Eddy plays for Team Canada. And if we looking for defense, you can't look no further than somebody that can actually play drop coverage successfully, because nobody's going to try Zach Eddy in the paint. At least on no level. I don't care if it's the NBA level. I don't care. It's no athlete in the world that's going to try him on that level right now. Like, you'll have to go back to the 90s to try somebody that's going to try him in the paint consistently. So I think it works. The one thing I will say is that if Zach Eddy does end up on this team, then we know Jordi Fernandez's influence is very, very real. If he doesn't end up on this team, then we just dealing with another yes man.
Right. Now, hold on. Shout to Leaf. And again, I did that because I didn't want to have a long live. You know what I mean? So, yeah, that's why I did the exact 46-minute live, as you said, that, which is hilarious. Shout to Leaf. But again, yeah, I was asking for you to pull up because – my thing is, I don't know how we keep Clax in the situation. Now, me personally, I think as a fan, now this is a fan perspective, not the business side of what they're going to do. As a fan, I would like to see Clax and Clowney start, and I want to see Zach Eddy get big minutes. I don't think them giving, and this is the business side. That's the fan side, but now this is the business side. The business side is you're not going to start Clax. I mean, you're not going to start Zach Eddy over Clax because you just paid Clax this big contract. Feel what I mean? But what I will say is, on the business side, I would trade CJ to keep Clax happy.
Well, here's the thing about it. First off, about Mikal and about Cam Johnson, let's just be clear. They only had a year and a half to get some things right, bro. Like, I'm all for bringing new people in as long as we don't have to get rid of anybody right away that has it that can or that can or will contribute to this team in the future and in a proper setting. I said this before and I'm gonna say it again. Mikal, DFS, and Cam Johnson, once they go back to their original roles that they were on their previous teams, on this team, then everything is gonna work out just fine for those three players. Now
bro, hold on. Let me just slow you down right quick. And I think this is what in my opinion, when it comes to Jalen Wilson. Jalen Wilson is the safety net for the Nets in case they trade Cam Johnson. That's how I feel. Like, they'll keep Mikal Bridges, but trade. Otherwise, why sign Jalen Wilson? Anybody seen Jalen Wilson getting signed like that? Just out of nowhere?
Well, I seen him getting signed because not only Jock Vaughn was interested in him, but the front office and management was interested in him as well. So they all liked what he brought to the team in terms of energy and effort. So it's a lot of things that he brings that Cam Johnson doesn't bring, and it's a lot of things Cam Johnson does that brings that he doesn't bring.
Like what? So,
like shooting and spacing, nah. Consistent. Listen, it's only been a year.
Hold on,
let me get this off. I ain't got that much time. Listen, I'm going to say this. I said what I said about Cam Johnson, Mikal, and DFS, and that all stands. You still need your veterans, and you still need your guys to bring it to help show the young guys the rope and bring them up the course. Obviously, Jalen Wilson, obviously, Wofford, and obviously, Noah Clowney is not where we want them to be yet. So, but I need you would like Mikal, DFS, and Cam Johnson to be around for their ultimate progress. That's my thing on that. Now, in terms of the dollars, it's a $100 million contract. That's basically crumbs today. And last time I checked, Claxton didn't play over 65 games. Therefore, he's not eligible for no crazy money. So that's one thing that we don't have to worry about. So we could still keep Claxton for cheap if he decides to stay.
Nah, but that's now, the thing. But hold on. If Clax is in a post in the press, if he in the media is saying, yo, I want to be part of a playoff team, a team that's going to compete. If we get Zach Eddy, Clax, and Clowney to be the front court for the Brooklyn Nets, bro, that immediately puts us back into play-in mode at minimum.
Absolutely. But I think here's the thing. The thing for the Zach, think of Zach Eddy basically as the insurance and the reinsurance at the same time. The insurance is because the thing was, like, when Claxton got hurt, we went totally small. But go look back at the games when Claxton got hurt, bro. We went totally small. How we stayed afloat during that stretch that we didn't have Claxton, I will never know. But we went totally small. We had DFS running the damn five, bro, for God's sakes, bro. That was just terrible. So think of Zach Eddy as the insurance and the reinsurance, bro. Like, so it's things that Zach Eddy could do that Claxton can't do, and it's things that Claxton could do that Zach Eddy can't do.
Right. No. But again, the reason why I was doing this and calling you out early in the stream looking for you is because I was the one saying I don't see how it's possible. And like you said, you learned this about 2 days ago when I did the stream. I didn't know that when you pulled up. I didn't even see you put that in the comments. You know what I mean? I didn't even see that. But I had seen it earlier, so I was like, yo, I definitely want to do a stream. I tagged you on Twitter. But that being said, now I think it's possible. I was saying that it's not possible. I don't see how it could happen. Now I really feel like it's possible. And if we, like you said, since Claxton played 65 games, we probably could afford him contract-wise, even if he do want the bag. Because those incentives get you that bag. And I think that's where the players, because, you know, the players got to meet association, like the Players Association. They sat down and spoke about this at a negotiating table. So case in point is the owners wanted them to play 65 games plus. So like, all right, so that means you got to play more than half of the games. You got to play majority of the games. And that take a lot of great players, or who we would consider great players in the league, out of the realm of getting the bag, because they don't play 65 plus games like a Donovan Mitchell. Respectfully.
Yeah, respectfully. And I'm going to add one thing before I pull off, because I'm in the car. So the thing about Claxton not playing 65 games, and you got to go back to the fact that he when he had Kevin Durant all the way up to the trade deadline, he was arguably a second team all defense. So an all defensive team and 65 games would have got him we would have had to come out of pocket for real. The fact that he didn't do neither, that means we honestly get to keep him for basically half, basically 50 cent on a dollar. So think about it as like, yo, we still got somebody that we drafted, and usually you know how bird rights work, man, because we could basically come out of pocket and we don't have to dig into the hard cap of the salary. So now with this situation with Clax being this season, now we don't have the opportunity just to keep him. We don't not only have the opportunity to get Zach Eadie, but we also have the opportunity to save money to still get the one free agent that we want, which is Donovan Mitchell, and still keep everybody on the team as opposed to trading for him and trading pieces for him and jumping the gun like we always do. But, you know, man.
Hey, Leaf, can I ask Leaf a question about the Eadie thing? This will be the last. Because I hear you, and I get it. But my main thing is, you got no picks. You're going to have to either buy in or trade. But my thing is like, it's as much as like, if it's there, yes, I think it's maybe it's a smart move. You take it. I just can't imagine them doing a full on offensive thing of like trying to particularly acquire those picks that are going to get that guy, like make that such a huge center. I kind of feel like it's going to be one of those things that they're going to see what picks they have, if they get any for this year via trade or buy-in. But that's going to be a hard, and depending on, I mean, that's the thing. Is this guy a very, I don't know much about him, and I'm going to look into him after this conversation, but is this a guy that is so coveted by other players? Because again, as much as I agree with what you're saying, it's just the pathway to getting him, I don't think as easy as it's going to be. Because of what so much shit we got to do. You got to get lucky with a pick. Let's be honest. You got to get lucky with a pick in a range that he's going to be, and then get hope that the person before you doesn't grab him. I'm just saying, it's not a guaranteed pathway to Eadie, is all I'm saying.
Yeah. That's exactly it. But
that's the only crux of this whole thing for me is like,
listen. I'll be honest with you, the realistically only way we can get him without giving up anything, like a picks, money, future picks, or anything, the only realistically way we could get him without giving up anything is that we can hope that a team picks him, because he's going to get picked, but he doesn't get signed. Therefore, he's going to be left on waivers, and if you know anything about waiver rookies or waiver drafted picks, you can pick them up for basically 10 cents on the dollar, but especially if they are late first round, second round pick, as he's projected to be for some odd reason. But he's not heavily coveted, bro, for the simple fact that he's 7'4", 300 pounds.
Leave, let me say this to you. Yes. What if the scenario is, whoever does get Zach Eadie, say we don't get him. This is how I really look at it. Say we don't get him. But whatever team does get him, we just work out a trade with him. Like, trade us Zach Eadie for these many draft picks and these players. Is that possible?
I mean, me personally, I think trading for him, bro, like with the draft picks that we have for the future, bro, like after this draft, I don't think it's worth it. But I don't think it's worth it in terms of what the draft pack, what the draft picks are worth right now and what he's worth right now. But the thing is, the thing about getting a Zach Eadie is that we have to build a competent speed team around him to, for him to be more successful than for him to cover, for all his weaknesses to be covered. So we're going to be whatever team uses him for 25 to 30 minutes, he's going to be playing drop coverage, and everybody else is going to be responsible for getting out to the shooters and speeding up and getting to the game and using their lateral quickness to go out and do all of those other things. Think of it how the Denver Nuggets high Jokic on defense. Think of it like that. So the paint is really covered with him. So everything else on the perimeter, if you don't want him to move as well, they move that much, you're going to put him in drop coverage. It's just that simple. But in terms of getting him, the only way we could possibly get him without giving up nothing is that we could hope that a team drafts him and doesn't sign him and leaves him on waivers. That way we could just sign him and pick him up. But I could tell y'all more on it later. I got to pull off, man.
All right, shout out to you, Leaf. There you have it, man. I said his motion to it, but saying he kept it real with us. He said, "Hold on, hold your horses." Claude's in the comments saying wishful thinking too. So again, but Jordi Fernandez coaching him, I think, gives it some type of motion. But you know, we'll see. Sean Marks, Brooklyn Nets cast. Shout out to Brooklyn Nets cast. If you're on Twitter, you might be on the show, man. Tell a friend to tell a friend. He says Sean Marks says he wants to develop our own star. Can't 24 staying. I believe it. You know, I think Cam Thomas is the star that the Nets need to see be developed. And I think this could change the trajectory, or not trajectory, but the narrative of what people say about Sean Marks. If Cam Thomas becomes a star for the Brooklyn Nets, if he's the face of the franchise, if he's the, you know what I'm saying, and him being a late pick in the draft, Sean Marks is going to, we're going to have different conversations about Sean Marks. And we're going to, and again, I just don't think, well, I will say this. I think the formula to winning in the NBA is building from the draft. It's hard to the kind of numbers Cam Thomas is putting up. I mean, you know what kind of money you have to pay a free agent? Like, it's tough. It's not easy. In my Mikal Bridges voice, it's tough. You know what I'm saying? Shout out to Mikal Bridges, man. Let me ask you this, Saint. What did you think about Mikal Bridges being transparent about not being mentally tapped in towards the end of the season? Like, what do you think about that transparency? Is the Brooklyn Nets fans you need to toughen up, or do we understand how we feel? How you feel about what he says, Saint?
Hey, Breezy, sorry, I did get a phone call. Are you asking me overall what I think about his overall conversation, or did he say something new that I missed when I got the call?
The transparency of him saying he was mentally checked out,
and he wasn't. Oh, Mikal Bridges.
Yeah, how do you feel about that?
I got flack for saying dude's like mentally going through it, and I mean it's like, I mean, dude, there's no way you can tell me from being the situation he was in Phoenix, just basically being able to just operate however he wants, play however he wants, really not have to deal with too much pressure, and then you come to New York. And depending on how you view that second half of the season after the trade with him, I think by and large, people were like, they weren't shitting on him like they were now. Like overall, they were like, there were still questions of whether dude was going to be this number one and all that. That conversation was going, but it became obvious to me during the season where it's like, hey, this guy is still on his streak. So one, you're telling me there's no way a guy that's on that long of a streak, he definitely plays through injuries. So I wondered if that was part of the issue this year. But the biggest thing for me was like, there's no way he's not all up in his head. Like you could just see it. Like,
that dude
wears his emotions on his sleeve more than anybody I've seen. It's just not his. And I think it was just way too much. I think he didn't know how to handle it. And then all the shit with the Knicks and then like his friends over there, just like, I bet you. And then he gets on the court. And remember, I remember you saying this too and talking about this in here. And somebody brought it up, but it was like, you even looked at his shot and his shot was like, just did not look the same. Did not have the same lift. What up, Joey? Like, it just, so for me, like, if overriding saying the number one issue for him, I definitely think dude was in his head more than anything this season. And I think it just, it threw him off his game. And then you throw in, and this was the aspect that I said why I'm not blaming any players for this season and really shitting on them. Hmm. Yeah, there's a few things of effort that we can talk about. But ultimately, how the Nets handled this season, set it up, and sold it, and then you had multiple players wondering if they were going to get traded all season, and then you change coaches. It's just like everything, like, how do you, like, damn, dude, from a player perspective, hats off to the guys that stay locked in and still give it their all every game. Because
that's because, again, he physically was there 82 games, but mentally, no.
No, mentally, I don't think he was there 80. That's the thing is, I'll say this, and I bet you most people would agree, most players on that team were mentally checked out. You can't tell me otherwise. We have.
But it's what's the word? It's infectious.
Yes, like, but did it start with him? I don't know. Look at Dinwiddie. We know that Dinwiddie was told he was getting traded from last season.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, you fast forward to now, as much as like Dinwiddie pisses me off, it's like, let's look at least the side of how the organization handled that with him. And dude thought he was getting traded last season. They told him that. He's like, I don't know why we're having this introduction, like pretty much saying I should be gone. Then you fast forward the season, nothing happens. And you get to the beginning of the season, still nothing happens. And then you finally get something. And it's like, bro, there. So what I'm saying is there's more than one player on this team that has been getting a little fucked up in the head by the organization. And then you couple on personal playing, like with Macau, where on some level he's like, he knows he's dogging it out there. There's no way that dude doesn't know he's not sucking. And it's like, that just played the biggest part. So it's like, know what I mean? I'm not going to say that that's on Macau, because that, no way, dude. Look at the situation the Nets created for players this season. And you tell me, if you were a player on that team, how comfortable you would feel about whether you were staying, getting playing time, or whether you were going to get hurt or your value would diminish. You cannot.
I think Jack Vaughn was more of a nice guy than he was an actual coach, a real head coach. Like, yo, you know, I don't want you doing that. And again, I would say stuff like, I'm trying to learn the game. Like, I'm like, yo, why they don't run plays for Mikal Bridges? And, you know, I heard Mikal Bridges, he complained when he said, yo, you know, they got me running playbook from KD. And he played great while he did that. So my point is, the style of play that he had in the last 28 games, was middies, then the three-pointer, because they was KD's playbook, and that was KD's playbook. That went from a bunch more three-pointers than two-pointers, and three-pointers first before two-pointers. So that was the major difference. And I think because he tried to play that way and went away from the KD playbook, it went bad for him. If Mikal Bridges goes back to the KD playbook, it will go good for him. But I don't think it goes good for him until he does that.
It's as simple as just putting him off ball and not letting him be the main focus. Once you put Mikal back in that position where he does not have to worry about bringing the ball up and being the man and getting double team all the time, like, once he's not that dude on the Nets,
right?
I'm sure he will play better. He just, nah, I don't fact. Think dude is built to handle all that pressure. Personally, I know that's stupid. I'm not an NBA player, and he can handle.
Nah,
pressure.
Did sure. you see? Did you?
But
did
I just don't see? Like. He just definitely, as far as being the center of attention, no.
Did you see him talking to Paul George like the summer before? Do you seen that? Where he was on
yes, I it's, but I did, but you'll have to remind me of if you're looking for a specific.
Yeah, he had. They had asked him like, "Yo, you know, you got the keys to the team now. How you feel?" And he, the way he answered, the way he replied to Paul, podcast P. Paul George, he was just real uncomfortable. He didn't even like the way it sounded. Like keys to the team. What I'm supposed to do with that? Why you give me the keys?
He was there, and so, but people also didn't want to like, because that's the other thing I remember from one of those, and I think it was Paul George, is when they around that same topic, just how they were like, "Yo, you're the man," and he's like, or like, "You're the center," and he's like, "No, I want to make everybody eat. I want to get everybody involved." He's like, "I don't want to just be the center," and it's like, that's kind of why I feel like it a little bit with the Macau conversation, that it was like the organization did him no favors, and then it's like, what are you supposed to do as that player? You're supposed to come out and go, "No, I'm not the number one," right? Like, so he takes it on. He's having a shitty year. He's not hitting anything. Cam Thomas destroys every Nets plan for the season. Mm-hmm. And it's like it just compounded from there. And then you add on this extended Iron Man thing that you can't tell me did not affect how he – like, I'm sorry. There were times that the coaches should have looked at him and told him to sit his ass down or not even start him, either because he looked injured – or just was dogging it out there. There were plenty of times that I think that did affect the season. And I think that fucked with him too. I think a lot of that fucked with him. Like,
yeah, no, I
will hear you. Will he turn it around next season? A lot of people seem to think he won't. I think if the Nets set him up correctly and they get that guy and they don't rely on Ben Simmons, I think we see a better, more consistent Macau. I am glad he did not get picked up on the USA team. I hope to God that guy does not decide to do anything like close to that in the off season. I hope he just chills and works on his game, gets a little weight up.
Mm-hmm. Watch film.
Yeah.
You know, watch film. Like, you don't have to be away from the game, but to physically put yourself through it when it's just as effective as resting. You know, people doubt what rest brings. Like, you want to be out there at your full potential, you know what I mean? Your full capacity. I don't want to see Mikal Bridges playing every game, but he had a 20% energy in his tank. You know what I mean? Like, you know, if he took a game off, I wouldn't be that mad. I thought one of the essential things about him playing every game is that he would make us a better team because of it. But sometimes I thought he would take ill-advised shots. His shot looked uncomfortable, and it was just like, you don't even have to shoot the ball. As a matter of fact, if you don't play that many games, just play defense.
Bro, they all but admitted it with that conversation around how the Boston was handled, that Boston game. Like, that Boston game was, like, so nasty how the Nets organization handled it. And it became, like, so that was another perfect example of things that either the organization and camp, and this is the part where Macau, that I do have an issue with Macau, and it's like, bro, if you are out there dog-assing it, whatever the hell you want to call it, like, just, and you look like Harden when he wanted to quit the Nets, like, have enough, like, fucking just, like, fuck your goddamn streak. What's more important, your streak or the goddamn team? And sometimes I felt like that was my issue with the Nets organization and the coaching, and maybe it was like, who knows, like, just, you can't tell me that dude wouldn't have been sat on some other teams in the NBA or taken a game or two.
Yeah, no, I agree. I think he would have been better off resting, because again, you got players like Jalen Wilson that he may not be as consistent as some Mikal Bridges, but he'll show up. You know, I think the Jalen Wilson was a good look, and I really think he's a safety net for the Brooklyn Nets. Seriously, like, I think Jalen Wilson, I like his game. I think he'll become a better shooter. But to the point, he's played a lot of organized basketball because it was in college. So, well, you know, with college, it's not like, oh, I just chuck the ball. It's kind of like, you know, you play in the system. You know, you play in a style that the coach, are you coachable? And Jalen Wilson seems like a player that could go from different systems. Not to say that the Long Island Nets and the Brooklyn Nets is so much of a different system, but I just like to think that he's somebody that we can rely on because he definitely played both sides of the balls. And I like his intangibles. I like the fact that he's scrappy. He'll get after the rebound. He second tries. He stay with the play. He plays the whole 24 seconds on the shot clock. You know, there's a lot of upside with him. So, you know, respectfully, I thought if Mikal Bridges, if you're going to play every game, at least shave your minutes. You know, you playing 35, 40 plus minutes for what? We got Jalen Wilson.
Well, they did. If you notice, though, towards the end when
Kevin Ollie shaved his minutes, but Jack Vaughn didn't.
Well, but what I mean, though, is like if you notice the second half of the season, too, especially the last like month, the amount of shots that he was taking went just way down. Like there were times that numerous times you'd enter the fourth quarter and he had only taken 7 shots for the game. So like there was also a switch away from, and this is why I speculate. Remember when he got his hand hit?
Yeah, I thought he was going to sit. I thought like he might miss a game.
I think that lingered on for at least a good 4, 5, 6 games for him, because at least visibly in 3 games after the fact, he was still doing, because I know people say, yeah, players shake their hands all the time. But this was the shake, you know, when you jam some shit.
Yeah,
you're trying to play basketball. I don't care whether you play professional or street ball or what in your backyard. Everybody has jammed a thumb or a finger or something.
Facts.
And that shit just sometimes does not go away and it becomes an issue. I mean, dude, just like in professional, like in NFL, and you hear all the stories about dudes just literally playing on injuries that would cripple us, and then the amount of drugs that they got to take to play. It's like, you can't tell me that does not happen. And like even a small proportion with somebody that is an Iron Man like that, like there's got to be some forgiveness from the organization or here or there to be like, well, he's got the streak, gotta let it go. I mean, you can't tell me a couple of those conversations didn't happen either.
Yeah, nah, I hear you. I'll be honest, man. I feel like the reason why I don't vlog about what the Nets are going to do, because they're so unpredictable. But what I will say is listening to the reporters, I would like to think Scotto, he's valid. You know what I mean? Lewis,
Scotto. He's very valid.
Yeah. These guys, I hear stuff from them. I'm like, oh, all right. If he said it, then there's some legs to it. I think they talk about Donovan Mitchell more than they talk about Trae Young, too. But the Donovan Mitchell, the reason why I told you why I wasn't really with it, but I don't know, man. Ben Simmons, I still feel the same way about him. I don't think we could think we could win contingent on his health. We would have to.
Oh no, if the Nets go into next season like they did this season, relying on Ben Simmons, yeah, no, it's gonna be nasty.
Yeah, nah, exactly. That's what I'm saying. But, you know, and that's what I mean. I think it's way more easier for them to, you know, maneuver financially if he wasn't on the books. But from what it seems, ain't no way to really, really dodge that, you know, unless it's a buyout or something like that. And respectfully, just on, you know, he's a great talent. And if he hit this one day, man, you're a great player. But, you know, this might be unfortunate, man, where you might have to retire, man. You know, and this is not even me trying to be funny or nothing like that. It happened to players that we didn't want to see it happen to. I think something like that happened to Lonzo Ball. You know, he was another one who had a career that was supposed to take off that it didn't happen. It looked like it's because of injuries. So it's not just him, you know. And I don't know. I just think him being there with the team, following the team,
you want my honest opinion on where
I don't know if he should have been there. He should have been home resting too, man.
My honest thing is what I hope when it comes when they're looking at Ben Simmons, I think you look to see if he can if they're taking a swing at somebody big and you can somehow throw him in that there as an expiring and they're willing to do it, you do it. But at the same token, it's like either way you look at it, like his contract to me is a positive. Like I'm not even looking at him as a player and what how he's going to contribute to the team anymore. I look at him right now, unfortunately, as a fan, I just look at him as, hey, bro, that's 40 mil coming right off and I can't wait. Like whether it's via trade, it fits in part of something, whether it's in the off season. Yeah. And then at that point, I don't give a shit. Guy comes back for a minimum. I really don't give a shit.
Yeah, no.
But seriously. I mean, if you put his health in the perspective of what he's going to make contract wise and you could get him back that cheap and he shits the bed, goodbye. But I just, Ben is a positive asset right now for us. And that's and it comes down to money. That's the only way I'm looking at him right now.
Yeah, no, I'm not even, like I said, I don't have a vlog like he going to be on the team helping at all. But yeah, no, I am excited about it. And to pretty much sum it up, what the title of the show was, as much as I want to say that I feel more motivated, I kind of do. No, I'm not going to lie. I kind of do feel like Jordi Fernandez, based on listening to Sane and Leaf pulling up on the panel and what I've seen thus far, I kind of do think that it's possible that we get Zach Eddy. I got to say, if I had to say yes or no, I would say yes. And if you're asking me how, I would say with a trade of maybe DSJ, DFS, CJ, and some draft picks. It's a lot to give for a team, unless they're going to try to utilize him the same way we trying to utilize him. I think
if he's a true second rounder, then I give Leaf's percentage rate to go above 50%.
Yeah,
because it's like it just if you're telling me he is going to be in the second round, the odds and ability then to be able to maneuver is a little bit easier if you're buying second rounds or even a small trade. Like you can get a little more. But if it's a first round thing, that to me is going to be then you've got to just get lucky with who you're trading and whoever you're trading with is going to give you a 2024 pick, whether it's theirs or somebody else's that fits. And then you can play ball, but we'll see. I mean, I have to dip out cause I got to go transfer some phones, but Marks has got it all laid out in front of him. He's got many options and it's exciting. And I'll agree with you. I'm very excited to see what happens with the Nets this offseason. There is some hope despite all the signs that should tell me I shouldn't sometimes.
Right.
But like, dude, it's get ready, buckle up. Like, cause you can't rebuild. Like the dude wants to rebuild, bring up our young guys, go get a star, re-sign every, like pick a lane, bro. And we're about to see what happens, but Breezy, I do appreciate, and this was fun talking with you and shout out to everybody in the chat.
Yeah, nah, but likewise, Saint. All the time, every time.
Every time, brother. I'll see you soon, man.
All right, later, Saint. Word. But, yo, man, listen, I'm going to be honest with you. I don't got much more to say. Leaf pulled up, Saint pulled up, and we spoke on it. And, again, I feel more motivated that Jordi Fernandez is going to recruit Zach Eddy. I think it's very possible. I think we could be looking at a team of Zach Eddy, Clax, Mikal, Cam Thomas, Schroeder, Clowney, Jalen Wilson, Trendon Wofford. How many players is that? Zach, Clax, Clowney, Mikal, Cam Thomas, Jalen Wilson, Trendon Wofford. That's eight. No, that's seven. Look like we're going to have a strong team. Cole Smith says, CT won't be a free agent until the end of next season. We should deal with his extension then. There's no urgency to do it before then. We have to wait for Ben's contract is off the books. Claude Smith, this is why you're one of my favorite
fans that be pulling up in the chat. And I'm going to expand on this. When Ben Simmons' contract is over, will be the same time that we Cam Thomas' contract is up to re-sign him. Let's do the numbers. Let's. You spell change wrong, Big Taz at hand. You spell change wrong. You said chained. What do you mean trained? Chained what? What's chained? Stop playing with me. Let's make sure. I'm having fun with this. Where you at, Nets Press? Oh yeah, this is fun. This off season stuff. He says, Nets Press, he came on here, he said the offseason more fun than the regular season. I'm having fun right now. I ain't going to lie to you. Shout out to Nets Press. He just hit 20,000 on IG. I like to think I helped with that. Not to say that I did, but I think he had like 19,980. I might have helped him with 20 subscribers. But if I helped him with 20 subscribers, I care about that, man. Shout out to Nets Press, one of the better Nets content creators. Shout out to Saint. Shout out to Nets Kingdom. Y'all know what's up, man. Subscribe to Leaf 4788. But yeah, man, this is Big Fan Breezy, and we're going to go to sports track, right? Because we're gonna see what's going on. We're going to see what's up with the what's up. Now look at Ben Simmons' contract. His contract is over 2024-2025. I want you guys to see what I'm looking at because shout out to Claude, man. You know what I'm saying? That's a super comment right there. You know what I mean? That's a super comment right there, and I appreciate that. So ego, let's get to it. He said, thanks, Breezy. I've become a big fan. Thanks, man. I appreciate that. Likewise. Fan of you in the comment section. Always contributing to the show. This has been Simmons' contract. 2024-2025, we got to pay him for one more season. 2025, we ain't got to worry about it. Don't even worry about it. But 2024, look at that. 2024-2025, that's what I want y'all to see. That's the season, right? Now, we go to Cam Thomas. Hold on, Preston. Here we go. 2024-2025. See that? So next year, we paying Cam Thomas, but we paying him $4 million. Then he's a restricted free agent. And like I said earlier, we could match the offer that he gets from any team. So when Ben Simmons come off the books, it's going to be time to put Cam Thomas back on the books where he's supposed to be making the money that he should as a franchise player of this team, respectfully. Yes, it should be widely known when it comes to Cam Thomas signing this next contract, that he is the franchise player on this team. Iceman said, did you listen to Mike Scott's report with Brian Lewis? Nah, I seen some of it. Pull up, Iceman. I tagged you on Twitter. I'm pretty sure I did. Hold on, let me throw the link in the chat in case you can't find the link. I'm about to dip soon, but I got a few more minutes. Oh, man. Yeah, listen. Definitely look like we're going to keep Cam Thomas. These are their contracts. So that's what it is. So with that being said, yes. Word. See if Iceman gonna pull up before I dip off. About to dip off real soon. Let's see. Okay. Mike Scotto. So they got some stuff. Reporting on Donovan Mitchell is potential trade target for the Nets. Nick Claxton free agency. Let's see what Iceman talking about. Yo, Iceman, what's goody?
Yo, what's good, bro?
Chilling, man. Just trying to figure out. Zach Eddy was selected by Jordi Fernandez on the Canadian team when he was under 19 years old. So we found that blogged on it earlier. But now we're getting into the Mike Scotto. Everybody keeps talking to me about the Mike Scotto and what he said. You heard anything? Talk to me, bro.
Yeah, he talked about a lot of things. He talked about Donovan Mitchell, you know, and Brian Lewis was asking Brian Lewis basically questions like what we would have, you know what I mean, about what do you think about is the team going forward looking to get a Donovan Mitchell or anybody else, you know? And basically he was like, they still waiting until 2025, but basically if anybody is wants out earlier than 2025, then they might have their hands in something depending on who it is, you know what I mean, type stuff.
Yeah. So let me ask you, hey, what's your opinion about the interview? Do you feel like they dotted all the I's and crossed all the T's, or do you feel like, you know, wish you would have asked them something else?
They basically dotted all the I's and crossed all the T's for the most part. I think for right now, like, you know, do you think Lonnie Walker or Trendon Watford or any of them going to get signed back? And Brian Lewis asked those questions, you know what I mean? And I was like, wow.
What did he say about Clax? Talk to me.
He said he's above 50% about Clax re-signing. He said Clax talked to him last year and said he wanted to be here, and he doesn't really think that has changed as much. And what he said about he want to be in a playoff team or a contender team or whatever, he said basically he has to say things like that because of being a free agent, you know what I'm saying, and going into the market, you would want to keep it on that type of term the way you're talking professionally, you know what I mean? So he said that he's more than 50% sure Clax is going to resign. As far as DSJ, Lonnie, and Trendon Watford, he was more so kind of like Trendon Watford is, he don't think they're gonna resign him. He said he liked what he seen from Trendon, but he's less than 50% sure that they're gonna resign Trendon Watford. And Lonnie, he was basically like on the fence. They could go either way with Lonnie, but he more so thought they would resign Lonnie Walker because of his early scoring, and he got treated differently by two different coaches, basically. So he's like, I'm not sure, but he figured they would sign Lonnie, and Dennis Smith Jr. He don't think they will sign him. That's the way it kind of went.
All right, nah, I appreciate it. Hold on, we got Mo Beezy on the panel. Mo Beezy, what's good, man?
What's good, Breeze, man? Salute to your show, man. Salute to the panel. Salute, Ice, man. Man, you know, man, I'm just stopping in, checking on my investment. Well, the Rockets investment, rather. I'm just checking in on the investment, seeing how things going, man, what y'all got going on. I don't got nothing to do this offseason. You know what I'm saying?
Really? What you mean investment? What investment?
You know what I'm saying? The Harden trade investment, man. You know, we got long standing investment with that, man. You know, that was a long term move. That wasn't a short term move for us, man. So, you know, I'm just checking in, seeing
so, what you so, like to know. But explain that. How do y'all benefit from the Nets? What investments? Explain to me from the Harden trade.
Well, to me, we got, you know, we're gonna swap y'all pick out next year with OKC pick.
So I just need y'all to be bad enough so we can get Dylan Harper. You know what I'm saying? That's really it. I'm not really,
you know, I don't want y'all to be like super bad or nothing. I just want y'all to be bad enough that we get Dylan Harper. That's all. That's all I really want.
So hold on. So who's Dylan Harper? He's a lottery pick?
No, he's going to Rutgers. He's a freshman. I don't know if he Ron Harper's son. I'm not for sure of that. But he's a point guard. He's going to Rutgers with Ace Bailey. And man, I seen a couple of little, oh my bad. I seen a couple of mixtapes of him. He looking nice, man. So, you know, I'm already looking into the 25 draft, seeing what's going on, man. So
that is Ron Harper's son, just to let you know it is.
Oh, okay. So I wasn't. They said it, but I wasn't for sure if it was or not. But yeah, that, you know. Other than that, you know. But the reason why I say that, man, is because like when we made this deal, man, everybody said we'd be 25 and 30. This shit won't matter. They left us for dead, man. And you know, and it is what it is. But you know, it's just how, you know, it's just hot karma. It's just karma for you, man. So for me, I don't have no ill will towards the team or nothing like that, but I do, you know, I ain't on no trolling shit, but I really do want to hear
like what y'all feel about the coach and what y'all outlook on what y'all gonna do this offseason.
Iceman, you want to answer that, Iceman? I'll go after you.
Oh, okay. So the coaching, I feel like he's gonna be similar in a way to Jock Vaughn, but much better in a way than Jock Vaughn. Meaning, he wants to run. He's a fast-paced coach. He wants to run. His specialty is defense, but he does pretty good on the offensive side. So I checked out his what it was still a developmental league. I checked out the teams he had down there without any real star players. He had Joe Harris on one of his team, and I think I want to say Caris LeVert. Or I forget who else, but those records were pretty good. And I watched the way the offense played, and it was quick, fast. You come off a screen, and if you're a shooter and you get a screen, you're not even dribbling. Like once you get past the screen, you straight pulling up. You know what I mean? So it's quick, fast.
Hold on. So to add context to your, what you're saying, for one, they said that he helped Keegan Murray, and that's the kind of way that his style of play, Keegan Murray, where the catch and shoot. So that's true. And also, pace-wise, remember the Kings, they were the best in the league last season. Not the season now, but last season. They were the fastest pace. So we know that the assistant coach contributes to some of the style of the play. You know, the head coach makes some of the decisions. I mean, the last decision, but the assistant coaches are essential. So, yeah, go ahead, Iceman. I was just wanting to add to what you were saying. Go ahead.
All right. So, yeah, so like I was saying, yeah, if you come off a screen.
Appreciate you Mobile. Go ahead.
Firing. And then ball movement, like transition ball movement in half court set. It's fast. Like, the ball is you. If you can get a point guard driving down the lane, like it's not like Ja Bond kick, driving kick. Like you're gonna bring two defenders with you. You know what I mean? The way that he had it set up, you have no choice but to bring two defenders with you because you're driving downhill constantly, and you kick out. Either you kicking out to a shooter or you kicking out to somebody else while they get setting the screen on the side, and you getting a shot. So. You know what I mean? Wherever the ball goes, somebody has an opportunity to either create again or shoot. You know what I mean? And then I watched the defense. The defense is pretty good. You know what I mean? Like, he's a very defensive-minded person. I didn't get to check out all the Sacramento stuff, but I wanted to see how it was when he didn't have star players or anything like that. And it was pretty good.
Yeah, no, again, I'm optimistic about him. I'm optimistic about even Zach Eddy coming to the team. You know, I'm interested in how well this team is going to look. I thought it was the earliest I ever seen a head coach move. I mean, technically the season not over and they already got him. Excuse me. So I could tell that they've been thinking about this for a while because, again, from the fan perspective, that has to resonate with them somewhere, even if some way or another Josiah is still making money, even with a losing franchise, he could see that doesn't resonate with the fan base. because business wise, they came here because of the access fans could have going to the Barclays the same way the MSG, the train stations is connected to the Barclays, like seriously, same way MSG. So I think that's more so what happened, and they're gonna make money, but you gotta have a winning product out there. You gotta have a winning product out there. Shout out to Joey BK in the building. Yo, Joey, what's goody, man? I told you I was gonna tag you when next time we do the show. I wanna say thank you to Joey and Iceman for pulling up. Talk to me, Joey. How you feel about Jordi Fernandez?
I got mixed feelings, man. I'm not opposed to it. I was hoping that we would get Bud. I didn't know too much about Jordi, and I started looking into, like, you know, his resume and stuff like that, and on how he was voted top assistant in the league, and how he was a hard-nosed coach. Like, he demanded a lot out of his players. He doesn't coddle players, but you know what I'm saying? He's still a player's coach at the same time, you know, hard but fair, you know. I mean, we'll just see how it goes. I think this is the Nets probably saying that, hey, they going the young route and they're not looking to star chase. I also seen a tweet from Nets Press that Sean Marks had he had a meeting with like all the season ticket holders, and he said that, you know what I mean, that two things that stuck out to me. He said that Brooklyn still might go after getting into this draft, and that Brooklyn is trying to homegrown their own star. So that leads me to believe that the Nets are probably going the young route, and I don't think that they're, if he's serious about what he's saying, that they're not going star hunting this offseason. So, and the hiring of Jordi also kind of proves that they're not going star hunting, because I think if they were going star hunting, they might have wanted to get a more experienced championship coach like Bud. But since they got Jordi, who's into player development, who was the young, best top NBA assistant coach in the league, I think they're going the young organic route in Brooklyn. So,
I'm with you. I'm with you. Mostly everybody agreed with it, even the ones that was opposed to it. Nets fans, you know, pulled up, said that Mike Budenholzer wanted a 10-year contract the same way. What's his name? He looked like Montel Jordan every time I think about dude. The play for the Pistons, coach for the Pistons.
Yeah, Monty Williams.
Monty Williams. Oh, it is Monty Williams, but I always think of the singer, Montel Williams. I'm bugging him. But him. He wanted a contract like that. And I heard, we expeditiously tell him no. Like, no, yeah. Hell, bro. 10 years is ridiculous. Like,
I kind of figured it was a mix of things. Like, I kind of figured that Bud was probably asking for too much power and too much money. And then at the same time, like, it wasn't the right time to really bring him in if we really wasn't going after the, being contenders. So why spend all that money on a coach if you ain't nowhere near contending like that? You know what I mean? So I think the Nets went the younger, cheaper route. So.
Yeah, but that's the thing. And, not only that, I'll say this. I think that he wants to go younger. I heard, Joe Tsai on that interview, and he was basically like, he got a son that's in high school. So I'm saying that to say his son is a fan of basketball. His son being a fan of basketball, he probably know about all of the draft picks, you know what I mean, in college, who he likes, this, that, and the third. You know what I mean? Maybe it's part of the reason why, Joe Tsai has a say in Zach Eddy being here, because they say he's from, his ethnicity is Asian. And maybe they just always been a fan of Zach Eddy, and with him playing so well, maybe they interested like that. But realistically, I don't know how they would pull it off, for lack of better words, pause or whatever. But I'm here for it. You know what I'm saying? I'm here for it.
But yeah, to JP Liberty's comment, here it is right here. He says, it's worth noting that the Nets might have struck gold and Noah Clowney, especially how weak our PF position is. Nets Press, this is Nets Press. Shout out to Nets Press. And Mike Scotto says, Noah Clowney had a heck of an end of the season for the Nets. He's been called the golden child, I've heard from a few people. That's huge. You know what I'm saying?
So, my bad. But what they said on that interview, right, they were saying, Brian Lewis is saying, it's not that the other people in front of him was doing poorly, but he's been doing good at the power forward position. And Brian Lewis is like, he wants to see if Noah Clowney did enough to knock one of those guys out of the power forward position, and probably would want to trade one of those guys as far as Dorian or Cam Johnson, and I forgot who else. Oh, because he said he took some of De'Ron Sharp minutes. So with those three, he wondered if that changed their mind that he could take a position at the four, and they trade one of those guys in the offseason or something like that.
Yeah, but we so ahead of the game on this show. We talked about this shit like weeks ago. About, and we had a debate on if Noah Clowney deserved more minutes and should he start for the Nets next season. We talked about that. And and some people were saying, you know, JNN was like, no, you know, you got to bring him along and this, that, and the third. And then it was the other side, like me and Breezy was like, let's put him in there and see what he got. He's already showing that he got you know what I mean? That he got a high ceiling, so why not put him in there and let him learn on the fly? He can't be no worse than what we already got at the four. You know what I mean? So, I mean, you got a young guy with that much upside. You got to put him in there, man, and see what it do. Like, don't sit there and waste him on the bench or keep playing him in the G League. Nah, you already know it's a desperate need at the four. You already know he fills that void, so why wouldn't you play him? And we've been saying, why didn't we get rid of Dorian? Like, last year we were saying at the deadline he should have been gone. Or like, you know what I mean? Like, it was just redundant when he was here with Roy. So I think it makes Dorian more expendable. I don't know how many years he got on his contract. I think he got like one more year, maybe one or two more years on his contract. But it makes him expendable, man, especially if we're trying to go younger. This guy fits the mold at the four, what you need. Why wouldn't you play him? Like, it's a no-brainer. You know what I mean? Like, play him, and see what you got.
Nah, I totally agree. Hold on. This is JTV. He said, yo, you kick somebody out for saying CT might leave? I said, yeah, he said. Jay said, unbiased opinion. I can't have a type of foolery in my chat. He said, I'm crying. Better watch their mouth about CT on the stream. That's a fact. Jonathan Asgatagui says, I saw the Mike Scott report too, Big Fan Breezy, and I think it's very interesting. Noah Clowney is getting so much praise as the golden child, while Cam Thomas hasn't got that praise as much. The golden child, I think, is just the stretch big. I wouldn't take it personal, you know what I mean? I don't think Cam Thomas, he knows who he is here, you know what I mean? I wouldn't feed into that. Exactly. But yeah,
why we always gotta pit. I noticed that in Nets where we always gotta pit our players against each other. Why can't they both be great and they both probably be a good fucking tandem duo going into the future? Like, you know what I mean? Like, I mean, and this is just a report. Ain't nobody say this is fact. So, I mean, we don't know if they really look at him as the golden child. Mike Scotto don't know that. That's just all some hearsay shit. My thing is, we want to put a young, talented team out there, and both Noah Clowney and CT fit the mold.
That's a fact. That I think when they talk about going young, they in that conversation too. You know, Cam Thomas is 22. Clowney, not even 20. You know what I'm saying? Like, he's still a teenager.
You know, so when you talk about going young, look at the roster we already got. And the one of the best things about a player development coach is being able to have the locker room, you know, because right. he's used to listening. Again, I heard a coach say this, oh, it's hard as hell to coach millionaires. You know, these guys, they got a different, you know, you do have to manage personalities per se, this right. and that. So there is some of that, but the players that feel like they got to something to prove, they're going to want to show that they belong in the NBA. They belong in the league. So we need that from a Jordi Fernandez. I'm excited.
I'm glad you said that. So, like you said, a lot of these older players, they already got their money. You got to understand, like, clowning them and Wilson and them, they ain't really seeing no real money. So when these guys get out there, they really trying to prove what they got, because they not only playing, you know what I mean, to for the Brooklyn Nets, they playing for the whole world to notice them. They playing for the rest of the NBA world teams to notice them. You feel what I'm saying? These young boys trying to get paid, so they hungry. And then on top of that, they more liable to listen than an older player. You know what I mean? As crazy as that may sound, because older players, some of them, you know, they've been in the league longer, and they might think they know more than the coach or some shit like that. The young guys, they going, I think they'll take more, you know, take advice better. You know, that's just my opinion.
Nah, I'm with you. How you feel about that, Iceman? You feel the same way?
About the young guys, I don't think they necessarily want to go young. I think they want to stay close to being the same, just in case somebody does come available that they want. You know what I mean? So I don't think they want to, just because we got that coach, because he's just good at dealing with players. You know what I mean? In general, he's just one of them coach players for the coach. I mean, a coach for the players type dude. You know what I mean? But yeah, young dudes do take in the information better than most older players. You know what I mean? Because they already who they are, and you know, they ain't gonna change too much. Exactly. But the young dudes will take in more information, like they talked about on that interview with him and Clax. Like, he's taking a lot of what Clax is giving him, and he's retaining that. You know what I mean? So
right, it's easier to mold a young guy, you know what I mean, into what you want him to do and be. You know what I mean? A direction that you know the position you want him to be in. You know what I mean? Some older players have been in the league, they just stuck in their mold or stuck in their ways. Like, you know what I mean? So,
I think, again, players like, and so we talking about coachable players now. If you ask me, since Clack's been a rookie till now, his game has improved. Around the rim better, around handling the ball better, staying healthy, conditioning himself to even play at a competitive level. I've seen a lot of improvement in Claxton, and I see room for improvement in Nick Claxton. Also, De'Ron Sharp, he's somebody that hit the gym. You know what I mean? There's a lot of players. I think all of the young players look at it like, this is an opportunity to prove my game. I think the G League is very important for the Brooklyn Nets. You know, having the players develop in the G League, play down there, so they get in minutes. So it's not like they just waiting to get play on the Brooklyn Nets. They actually have somewhere to play basketball competitively in the G League until they actually get to play on the Brooklyn Nets. I think that's why the transition for Noah Clowney was good, because we weren't feeding him the ball at first. He wasn't getting a lot of attempts at the basket. We just wanted to see how he run with the team and whatnot, if he played the defensive side of the ball, because he was scoring, like, I think shot 20 points. And I think he averaged like a double-double with the G League. So, you know, yeah, I see more positives than negatives, and we've seen a lot of negatives. I mean, we were 32-50, man. That, we went through a lot this season, man. Hold on, man. I want to shout to everybody that went through this season together, because 32-50, bro. When the last time we been this bad? I thought we was going to be as good as we was when Kenny Atkinson had us at like 40-something wins. We were really a under 500 team this season, man. And I don't think the Nets are trying to build a rapport with the fan base that we're going to be have back to back seasons while under a 500 ball club. I don't think we take a same type of swing we did with KD and Kyrie, but I do expect us to be more competitive next season. No lie.
I mean, the reason the season went the way it did because the core that we were looking to lead us into this season were either hurt. Or they was underperforming, you know what I mean? Or a little bit of the two. Like, Ben never really got going. He never really even played the majority of the season. We can say, is it honest to say CJ probably underperformed this season, and he was hurt a couple times? Is it honest to say that?
Yeah,
I mean, I see a lot of Nets fans trying to trade CJ, so I would hope I'm right about that.
Yeah, I agree with you.
I'm mad that
it's a looming question whether we sign Clax after we sign CJ. You know, we signed CJ after 20 something games. That's all the strength of Mikal. It could be nothing else.
And then Mikal, like, he kind of. I mean, I'm not trying to shit on Mikal or nothing, but he kind of underperformed based on what we were thinking what he was going to be this year. Not saying that he was totally trash, but we thought Mikal was going to be close to scoring 25 points a game and, you know, being the number one option for the Nets when we seen that 27-game stint last year. So
hold on, let's speak to what Jay said with Mikal Bridges, because he had he openly and admittedly said that he was mentally tapped out. So, and Jay says, this is JTV, subscribe to This is JTV. He said, realize that you're not that guy is a big blow to the ego. Do y'all contribute that to his lack of confidence in playing his shooting slump last season?
Not like Iceman, go.
It's a lot of things. The way the team is playing, right? Like, you lose Ben, Cam Johnson keeps going down. You know what I'm saying? And it's you, and you feel like it's you and CT, right? But after a while, that weighing on your shoulders, the style of play is changing, because he started to decrease towards All-Star. So he started to decrease then, because he was still at 22. He was still at 22 points a game. So after All-Star, like, he really lost it. Like, he was done. So he talked about it. A lot of the double teams.
Keep going. I got a phone call. I'm going to be right back.
All right. So a lot of the double teams, a lot of the triple teams, a lot of things that he wasn't accustomed to attribute to his frustrations. You know what I'm saying? And he couldn't handle it well this season with everything going on. So what you got?
I agree with that. I think it was a mixture of things. I think they, you know, he fell into a slump, and then on top of that, like, the supporting cast that he had around him didn't help make it any better. You know what I mean? They was looking at him to lead a team. You know what I mean? That wasn't, was lacking in talent and size. And then on top of that, he was limited in his skill set. So on top of that, and then on top of him slumping, trying to do it, I do kind of think that killed his ego a little bit, or kind of killed his, what's the word I'm looking for? That kind of killed his confidence a little bit. You know what I mean? Just a little bit, because it's like, yo, man, I'm out here trying to do these things that they asking me to do. And, you know what I mean, with what we got, and I can't do it. So, I mean, I think he just kind of fell back a little bit and kind of let CT kind of take over most of the scoring weight on the team.
Yeah, so that went in. That's why Ali just kind of took the ball out of his hands and put it in Schroeder's and Cam Thomas and see if they can get him back going by pushing the pace. But like I said, they couldn't really push the pace, because they're not those type of guys. So that's why it looked like that for him towards the end of the season.
That is true. That is true. Because we wanted to try to play like a West Coast offense in Brooklyn with Ben. We wanted to with the run and gun type shit. And we wanted Mikal and CJ and all the 3-point shooters we had around Ben to pitch in with that. You know what I mean? And if you don't have the right type of point guard, like you said, to kind of run that fast pace, get out in transition, you know what I mean? Beat the defense down the court before they can set up and, you know, get open shots. It's hard to do that. And we only really had one guy on the roster that could do that, and he couldn't stay on the court. So right. That's kind of going to affect his play, because then you start seeing us playing a lot more half-court basketball and the game slowing down, and, you know, the court gets smaller in the half-court set. You know, it's less space, you know. Definitely. What I mean, to operate. So, yeah, man. So, I mean, I think I agree, though. I think it was a mixture of a lot of things. I think it was a mixture of the personnel he had on the floor with him. I think it was a mixture of just him being in a shooting slump. And I think it was a mixture of a lot of things. I don't think it was just one thing, you know. They were asking him to do things that his skill set wasn't, you know, he didn't have in his bag, you know. So
yeah. So hold on, let me ask y'all this. Do y'all, this is how I feel, and then y'all let me know if y'all agree or not. I think before the season start, Mikal Bridges should do a Nets fan podcast. Whether it be me, any Nets fan. You know, because if you could do a Knicks fan podcast within the season, in the off season, he's saying he mentally tapped out, he probably listened to Twitter. He hear all of the rapport from the fans. You know, I would imagine that would contribute to him, you know what I mean, mentally tapped out. Him even commenting on, oh, I felt like it was an away game and I was home. But I thought he was being naive to the fact that the Knicks fans is, we live in the same place. It's not like they travel. These are your neighbors. These are not, you know, you got to travel across mad different borders and bridges. Nah, these guys not even taking what
it has to do with anything, though, man. Like, go out there and play basketball. How about you try to be a part of the solution and try to change that narrative? Like, we already know the history of New York City fucking basketball. The Knicks were playing in New York as the only team in the biggest metropolitan area since the 1960s. They already got their roots here. Like, they've got a homegrown fucking fans that's been generations of fans that's been groomed since the fucking 60s. So it's up to you to play well for the smaller fan base in the city, the Nets. Play well for us. And by doing that, you recruit new fans. And then not only do you do that, you shut up big mouth Knicks fans.
Right. So hold on. But do you think that he should do a Nets fan podcast just to kind of, you know what I mean?
I want Mikal to do, because with all that you saying he tapped out, I'm hearing he wanted to play on the USA team this fucking summer. So he can't be that fucking tapped out.
No. Let me real quick. He said they asked him about fever and stuff. Fever and earlier. A little while before the season ended, he said he didn't want to do none of that stuff. He wanted to concentrate on other things. But they was trying to give him a spot on that, and Kawhi decided to take it.
I want him to rest. That's why I want you to get some rest, Mikal. That's what I want you to do. I want you to rest up, and I want you to work on your game. That's what I want you to do and get ready for next season. You know what I mean? You don't need to be playing any, unless it's some fucking pick up games with some NBA players or something, some type of training shit. That's the only basketball you should be playing in the summer. But I want my man to chill, man. We need him not to just be playing for a game streak, a playing game streak. We need him to be playing winning basketball when he's going for that game streak. You know what I mean? That playing streak. Like, it's cool, like, if you out there and you trying to get this streak, but if you're not playing basketball, you just out there playing good basketball. You just out there doing cardio, my man. Like, we need you to play good basketball for us more than anything. So.
Yo, yeah, nah, I'm with you. I'm with you, bro. Listen.
But, yeah, he should be he should be doing Nets stuff with Nets podcasts and all of that. Like, I mean, but we know he not going to do it. And we know the reason he only did the other podcast is because he friends with Hart and old boy and Jalen Brunson. So,
Yeah, what yo, Iceman, what about you? You think that he should do a Nets fan podcast?
I think once he gets his mind right, you know what I mean, to enough to handle the questions on a Nets podcast, you know what I mean? Once he gets his mind right, then I think he should do it. I don't think he should just do it just because, you know what I mean? When he get his rest and he get it, you know what I'm saying? He get back to his confidence up and all that, and he can handle all the questions, you know, folks on the podcast going to ask him, then I think he should do one, you know what I mean?
I don't think it's safe for him to do one until he start playing better. So he got to wait. He got to wait to do that.
Hold on. Shout out to DJ Aguero. He says he should recruit Edie Breezy. Yeah, thanks. That's what we was talking about. Subscribe to the show if you're not already subscribed. And I appreciate your comments, man. Join the panel with us one time. We got me, Joey BK, and Iceman cooking. Listen, I think we all we want the best for this team, but let me ask you, do y'all care if De'Ron Sharpe is in that trade package, because of Noah Clowney? Do y'all think they exaggerate in Noah Clowney, or is it okay to trade De'Ron Sharpe if we want because we got Noah Clowney?
I will say is exaggerating, and I'm gonna say why, because at the center position, I don't think he's there yet. But at the four position, I think he's good enough right now to play the four. But at the five, if we complain about Claxton at the five, then you definitely gonna complain exactly. With him at the five. You know what I mean? With him at the five. So you need De'Ron. But if you're talking about Dorian, then I could see the switch. You know, I could see the trade Dorian for whatever and have him and somebody else at the four, but not De'Ron. Like De'Ron is
okay. So you say you could see DFS on the trade block before De'Ron Sharpe?
Yeah, basically.
Yeah, I absolutely agree with that. I absolutely agree with that. Like Iceman said, if we gonna get rid of De'Ron, and then we don't know if Clax is it's a high possibility he might not even be a Net, you know what I mean? And then what that just leaves you with, you know, Noah Clowney, like, and then like he said, Noah Clowney, he's not physically there yet. He's to be a five or to withstand that type of, you know, punishment, you know, going up against the bigger fives in the league. I think you need De'Ron. I mean, worst case scenario is De'Ron and Clowney. If Clax go, I could see Clax and DFS going before De'Ron and Noah, for real. Dead ass. Only because Clax is probably about to get paid, and I don't know if the Nets are going to pay him. And for the fact that Noah Clowney is probably showing promise, and that makes Dorian Finney-Smith expendable.
Nah, that's a fact. The chat got some questions. I'm about to close out soon, but I'm glad that Joey BK and Iceman on the panel. Y'all want to – DJ Aguero, he asks about Spider. Y'all want to get y'all thoughts on Spider?
Spider, it all depends on if he wants to come in. Like, I don't mind if he's on a roster. It just depends on who's come off the roster. I know some people don't care who comes off the roster. They just want him on here because they're trying to win. But it depends, because if he comes here, then you know you got to go out and get other pieces and make it work. So you're forever trying to, you know, make it to that championship, you know what I'm saying, status with him on the roster or whoever else you got to get. So, you know what I mean? Like, it's already become if he wants to be here, but who's leaving? That's always the question. Somebody got to go because he ain't coming for free. You know what I mean?
Yeah, no, I'm with you. Joey, you want to answer that question about Spider?
Yeah, I'm cool with it as long as we don't give up much, and I don't think that's possible. And then on top of that, man, we still got a lot of fucking dead weight like on this roster that's, you know, need to be moved on salary wise as far as CJ and Ben. It just, I don't know. I don't think it's going to happen, man. And if it does, we're going to wind up giving up a lot of assets. And then, like Iceman said, you got to work around getting other pieces to come here to play with him. So I don't know. I don't think it's going to happen, but if I wouldn't be opposed to it as long as we don't fucking give up a lot of assets to get him here.
All right, so not to say that I'll be back to hate on other teams. That's not necessarily what I want to do, but I'm about to leave soon. I wanted to thank Iceman and Joey BK for joining the panel, but I said all that because I think a playing game comes on later. I could be here for it if y'all trying to, you know what I mean, have the game in the background. Y'all could have, you know, y'all could talk about it and whatnot. It's all good with me, you know what I'm saying? It's playoff basketball. Wish we was there. So I might pull up later, you know what I mean? Not no specific team, you know, whatever playing team is playing. So I figure I'll cover the playoffs this season. I got some more Nets fan content in the works, but and again, man, you guys, y'all be on the panel with me on a regular basis. So y'all know how to find me. If y'all got any content y'all want me to discuss, you know, just y'all know it's easy to reach me. So, you know what I'm saying? Just let me know. But yeah, nah, man, Nets fans is the best fans. I appreciate y'all. I want to say again a big thank you to Joey BK and Iceman helping me grow the panel. Please sub if y'all already haven't. But yeah, man, until next time, peace out.
All right.
What that looks like for you. Being steadfast, keeping your nerve. Don't lose your shit with this group. Being tougher as a group.
A promise. Watch me like a cam, cause it's my time. Make sure watch me like a cam, cause it's my time. Switch, they can't guard me, especially side the Barclays. Spin between crosses, so I can score with both hands. Mini flawless, and I get to paint like an artist. I'm a boss myth, so you should respect my handle. I see the big picture with the Nets like a mantle. In the future, I see us in Shamsu. And when we do, I'ma do a Brooklyn dance move. Stir that whole Millie rock like a fan do. And that's a bet like my parlay on FanDuel.
B-R-O-O-K-L-Y-N. B-R-O-O-K-L-Y-N.
Choice every day, what that looks like for you. Being steadfast, keeping your nerve, don't lose your shit with this group. Being tougher as a group.